All right. Well, it's my favorite time of the week. It's time I get to do what God has commanded that I do with my life. And so I thank Him for the privilege, and I thank you to have someone to talk to. That would be kind of weird to just get up here and do what He's asked me to do, to talk to nobody. That'd be kind of awkward. And so I appreciate your desire to follow His leading and to come and to hear from Him and to praise Him. So here we are. We're back here in church, and I want to just kind of bring you back from what we've been doing the last, I don't know, 7 or 8 weeks, is we've been studying through the Gospel of Luke. And so what we said is that Jesus was going to build His church, right? And the way we do it is to partner with Him by lifting up the name of Jesus. And when we lift up Jesus, He draws people to Himself like a tractor beam in a sci-fi movie, right? And so that's what we've been doing. We've been studying through the Gospel of Luke, and we're finding out about Jesus. We're just preaching Jesus, and we're probably going to preach Him for a year. Okay? That's what we're doing. So I want to share a little bit of my world with you this past week. I felt very, very, I'll just say motivated, led, feeling, whatever you want to call it. I don't want to get all super spiritual with you, right? I just feel like I should have been doing a little fasting and praying and just seeking the Lord, you know, just a little bit more intense in my pursuit, you know? So I felt like I should fast and really, really hunker down to hear Him and get to know Him and hear His voice and pray and all that kind of good stuff, right? And so during that process, I was just led to Psalm 119, like, I'm not studying Luke to get a message. I just want to hang out with Jesus, right? So I'm hanging out in His Word, and I'm studying through Psalm 119, and as I'm reading Psalm 119 over and over again, it's funny because a lot of places, I think it was Mary that told me that at her school, that when you're naughty, the teacher makes you write Psalm 119, like for punishment, right? Because it's the longest section of Scripture. And they have it all wrong. It's not punishment, it's a privilege. That book is awesome, right? Like, it was incredible. So as it's ministering to me, I'm thinking, man, I was going to preach Luke, but I'm reading this, and man, He's just pouring out on me, and I'm like, man, I love these people. I got to share this, right? I got to share this. So I got that, right? And then earlier in the week, I met with this young man who was a minister of the gospel, great young man. And he lived out of state, and he just moved here. As a matter of fact, he moved locally, and he's part of another church's team. Like, he's part of their ministry team. He's an awesome guy at an awesome church. But he called me. He's like, listen, I want to know more about your church because I'm part of this other church, but I want to partner with you because I've heard great things, and I want to know how, even though I'm part of this church, I want to partner with you to help your church reach the world with the gospel. That's awesome, right? I'm going to say this too. He's black. What is it with you guys, man? You're awesome. You guys are awesome. So he said, tell me about your church. So I was thinking, like, how do I just describe the church briefly? White. I love it. That was a great answer, man. Keep that camera ready, man. We're gonna go all night right here. So anyway, all of a sudden I was like, well, you know, I won't use his name. I said, you know, so-and-so, our church has an identity statement. It's just who we are. And I think it accurately describes who we are. Revolution Church is a gospel-centered, culture-creating community bringing beauty to the world. That's who we are. And he's like, well, what does that mean? I said, so I explained to him, let me explain it to you just so you know. Because if someone asks you, hey, tell me about your church, you should be able to tell them, hey, we're a gospel-centered, culture-creating community bringing beauty to the world. Awesome. What the heck does that mean, right? So you want to be able to explain it to them. So let me just explain to you what I mean by that. We're gospel-centered because we realize that this doesn't exist except for the gospel of Christ. That because of the gospel, this is what happened. He brought us together. that this church does not exist beyond the gospel of Jesus Christ. We realize that. That the reason why we exist is because of the gospel, and therefore every single thing that we do is to promote the gospel to the ends of the earth. That's the reason why we're here. It's the reason why we exist. It's the reason why we function. That's why we're gospel-centered. We're a culture-creating. Let's stop there. Culture-creating. What does that mean? The Bible says that we're not supposed to copy the behaviors of the world. We're not supposed to be like everybody else. We're called the, this is churchy, ecclesia. We're the called out ones. We're still living on earth, I think. Although I wonder sometimes, I'm looking around going, what in the world? But we're still here on this earth, but we're not to live by the same standards that everybody else lives like, right? Don't copy the behaviors and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. We're different. We're called out of this thing. We're to live with a different standard. So we're not supposed to be in this culture living up to its standards. We're supposed to offer the world a different way to live. And that's exactly what Jesus did when he looked out at the landscape of his culture at the time. He said, y'all are doing it wrong. Here's a new way. And if we're to be Christ-like, a church of Jesus Christ, we have to walk in his exact footsteps and offer a different way to live. So that's why we're culture creating. We're also a community. Because like the picture said a moment ago, we need each other. We will never be effective in offering a new way of life to people single-handedly. We can't do it alone. We need each other, right? So we're a community. God has brought us together to do this. It's critical mass here, yo. I could feel it about to explode because we're all here and we have a spirit living inside of us. And so when it all gets together, it's like, it's getting ready to blow. That's what a community of faith should be, full of energy, vitality. Supposed to bring beauty to the world. So if you've been saved, I pray you have. If you've been saved, what's the greatest beauty you could bring to the world? Oh, hallelujah. Say it louder, Troy. Come on now, man. We got two more back there. They can say it loud. That's right. That's right. To bring the gospel elsewhere. Right? That's what Jesus did. He's like, I can't stay here. I got to go to the next village. I got to get people saved, man. So that's what we're supposed to do, bring the beauty of this new way of life to the world. That's our task. That's the mission that we've been set on as Revolution Church, right? A sudden and momentous shift in the status quo. That's what we need to bring to the world. And the guy's like, man, that's awesome. He was fired up about this little identification statement. I don't know if you're fired up. I'm kind of fired up about it. He was kind of fired up about it. And he says, well, tell me your vision. All that is great. How is that supposed to look? And I answered him, and he went from fired up. You could just see the wind go right out of his sails when I told him what I told him. I'm going to share it with you. Because vision in the church world is a big thing nowadays. Everyone's talking about it. There's book after book after book of church leaders talking about vision. And I don't buy into it. How many people have had a vision for their future? I knew I'd get a good laugh. Okay, keep your hand up for a second. If you had a vision for what should be, come on now, right? And how many people had it happen? What's wrong with you visionaries? You got to have a vision. If you don't have a vision, the people will perish. Yeah, I got a vision. God's vision. I don't even know what he wants to do. I thought something a whole lot different. Years and years ago, I said, man, we're going to have an awesome church. It's going to be rocking and packed. And we ended up in the upper room at a restaurant in Mount Dora with 15 people. That was my grand vision. Follow me. Woo! I have no vision. I have no vision for what could be. I have an idea of what I'd like it to be, right? Don't you guys probably have an idea of what you'd like your church to be like? Maybe you could close your eyes for a second and kind of visualize what would be awesome to you. I got a vision of what I think would be awesome, and it's probably not the same as yours or the same as yours, but it's probably pretty awesome. All of us would have an awesome vision, but listen, we got to lay down our own visions and we got to pick up God's vision. He does have a vision for what his church will look like and how it will function. And so really, my vision is supposed to be God's vision. And so I say that to say this. The Bible says in 2 Timothy 3:16 that all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching and correction, and that God uses this to prepare his people to do his work. All his work. So whatever that vision is in all of our minds, the way he's going to get his church to get there and do it is through the Word of God. He uses this to prepare us all to do every good work. That's what it says. And so it's his word that makes it happen. Hebrews 4:12 says that God's word is alive and powerful. So it's God's word, and he uses it to get us to do every good work. And it also says that it has the power, the ability to get you to do it. It also says in Isaiah 55:11 that God's word never returns void. Now, what that means is, and you can look it up in the New Living Translation, it'll explain it. Let me explain it to you. It says that when it goes forth, when it is spoken, that it always accomplishes the task that it set out to do. So it's God's word who inspires. It's God's word that has the power to actually make it happen. And it never fails when it's preached. And so therefore, Paul, this great apostle, says to his protege, Timothy, in 2 Timothy 4:2, that I plead with you in the presence of God to preach his word. That's the vision of the church. That's how the church will achieve its goal, is if we preach the word of God. And if we preach the word of God, God's vision for his church, according to his word, will happen. Amen. It will happen, okay? And that's what we're going to do here. We have to be a church that preaches the Word of God. So, that being said, I'm in Psalm 119, right? And I get to Psalm 119, verse 61. And here's our theme verse for this message tonight. This message called Anchored. It says, I am firmly anchored to your instructions. I am firmly anchored to your instructions. What happens to a ship that's anchored to the ground with this big, heavy anchor dug into the ground? When the storm comes, it stays, right? And that should be us. And so if the psalmist was saying individually, I'm firmly anchored to your instructions, where are his instructions? Right here, right? If I'm firmly anchored to your instructions, then a church is just nothing more than a group of people that should all be firmly anchored to his instructions. We don't need to hear a bunch of other stuff when we come to church. We need to hear the Word of God. And that's what I venture to do all the time. Now, firmly anchored has kind of a triple meaning. Kind of like Acts chapter 2 when all the people got together and it said that they were devoted to the apostles' teaching. That means not just that they were devoted to hearing it, but what else? They were devoted to what? Doing it, right? It was twofold. They didn't just want to do it without ever hearing it because they wouldn't know what to do. They kind of go hand in hand, right? They were devoted to it. So it's the same thing here. I want to be firmly anchored to your instructions. So I would say that it's got a triple meaning. I would say, first and foremost, I would want them. I want your instructions, Lord. The second thing would be that I would want to study your instructions, which we'll see according to the text means not just study, but to meditate and to memorize your instructions. I want them. I'll study them. The third one is I'll walk in them. I will walk in them. Now that sounds like a heavy burden to put on somebody. And you know, we're supposed to ease each other's burdens, and Jesus is supposed to ease your burden. And we don't want it to be religious. We want to just kind of flow with God, right? It shouldn't be very, very difficult. It's kind of burdensome. It doesn't sound easy, no. it's not easy. It's not easy at all. But I can tell you with complete confidence that it's best. That it's best. See, you have to make a choice in your life. You have to choose whether you want it to be easy or you want it to be best. We all have to make that choice. And so I want to entertain that choice here in the text. Just see what God says about it. Can we do that? Okay, and I want you just listening to my opinion. So what I want you to do is I want you to pick up a copy of God's Word. Don't cheat yourself. Either grab one of these blue ones that you see around you, or grab your device, whatever it is that you have. But don't cheat yourself. Put your eyes on the greatest treasure that God has ever left the human race. It's His Word. Okay, put your eyes on it. We're right here in the text. Now look in Psalm 119. What I had said was that we have to make a choice, that we're either looking for easy way or the best way, and we have to make a choice. So look here in Psalm 119, just right there at the first, right at the beginning. Are you there? I don't want to leave anyone behind, so you're there, right? Okay. Joyful are people of integrity who follow the instructions of the Lord. Joyful are those who obey His laws and search for Him with all their hearts. The King James, the New King James, the New American Standard, and NIV would not use joyful. They'll use the word blessed. But blessed is sort of a churchy word, because we all say, like, hey, when you sneeze, right? Bless you. Well, that was a blessing. Man, I'm blessed to do that. I'm blessed, blessed, blessed. We use it for a bunch of different things. And you know what? If you actually look up in a concordance that tells you the meanings of words in the Bible, blessed does have a variety of different meanings. But in this text right here, in Psalm 119, and the translators for the New Living try to explain the word blessed to you so you understand, they use the word joyful, and I think that's decent, but it's really not that. See, there's a ton of different definitions for different words in Hebrew. That's one of the mysterious things about the Hebrew, is that some words have a variety of different meanings. But this word, blessed, right here, has a singular definition to it when you look it up in the concordance. It's happy. Just happy. You don't hear too much about that in the church, do you? I think happy kind of gets a ripping in church, doesn't it? We talk about joyful, and you want to have that joy, joy, joy down deep in my heart. Woo, down in my heart. Woo, right, all that. But listen, the Bible, according to God's Word, right, God's Word talks about you just being happy. I want to be happy. Does anybody else want to be happy? If you want to be happy, I ask you to do this a lot, but I want you to do me a favor. If you want to be happy, just lift your hands. Okay. Everybody in the room wants to be happy. Some of us put up two. I love it, right? Except Michael. He doesn't want to be happy. But he's holding a Bible, so that means something. Yeah, he's happy. Yeah. He's graduated. Graduation service will be next week. We'll give him his diploma. He's happy. I want to be happy. But you know what? You guys are an amazing group, because not everybody's like that. Some people are just grumpy. Just grumpy, right? Walking around. Listen, I'm not talking about people outside the church. I've been up at this pulpit now for like 12 years. I've seen some grumpy people in the seats. Just, then I'll like Michael, I got all the joy I could have, with a smile. They're like, I got all the joy I could ever want. They love the idea of change. They just don't want to see it in their own life. Someone say amen. Come on now, right? That's awesome right there. It's true. Grumpy, grumpy, grumpy. Just they got wrinkles that won't go away no matter what they do. Huh? Yeah. They'd break the needle if they stuck it in their face. I want to be happy. And I believe from reading this, I think God wants you to be happy. I do. Do me a favor, keep your hand in Psalm 119, see if you're awesome, and go to Joshua chapter 1, two places in Bible at one time. Can you do that? Go to Joshua chapter 1, look at verse 7. We make it easy for you. Put the page number up there and everything. Spoiled rotten. You should all be smiling right now. Gunhammer, you got your Bible open? That's a man. That's what I like to see. All right, so Joshua, I just want to be happy, right? Joyful are the ones who follow. Psalm said, joyful are the ones who follow the instructions of the Lord. Joyful are those who obey His laws, right? That's not the only place. Look here in Joshua chapter 7. Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then, someone say then. Then you'll be successful in everything you do. Study this book of instruction. Who's got one? I got one. Study this book of instruction continually. That's a burden, Lord. Okay. Meditate on it day and night. Ay vey. Right, listen, meditate on it day and night so you'll be sure to obey everything written in it. Here's the clincher. You ready? Only. Oh yeah. Someone else say that. Let me hear it. Only. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all that you do. Yeah. Dang. I thought I could do it another way. I thought I could circumvent the system. I thought I could make up my own system. He's so into it, he's getting two Bibles. I love it. I want to be happy, man. I want to be happy. I need a couple more Bibles. Yeah. I want to be happy. So on this issue of happiness, I want to read you something that I found this week. Someone sent me a picture of the ultimate warrior. That's awesome. Who did that? Who was it? Damn, that was cool. Okay. I can't. What's wrong with my... Come on, phone. Okay. This is Forbes magazine, right? I read this in Forbes. You know what Forbes magazine is? The money magazine, right? The money magazine. Yeah, I don't read it. I can't even afford Forbes magazine. It's pathetic. Okay, so there's an article. We're talking about happiness, right? There's an article in Forbes magazine. This is recently. This is back in 2015. It's called Why the Pursuit of Happiness is Making You Unhappy. So here's the article. This is how it starts out. Be honest. Have you ever looked in the mirror and wondered why you're not happy? You're not alone. Life is not what I expected, quote unquote, a friend told us last week. My husband and I both have educations. We both have jobs that pay well. We have nice things and take great trips, but sometimes we both just want to run from it all and do something more meaningful. Our friend's comments resonated with us, as it's not the first comment like this that we've heard from friends recently. In fact, feeling, quote unquote, not happy might be more common than you think. In their poll of 2,345 U.S. adults, they use a series of questions to determine Americans' levels of contentment and life satisfaction. According to the results, a dismal 33% of Americans said they were very happy. So what's up? Why in a nation that entitles us to the pursuit of happiness are so many people not feeling that energized spirit? Why aren't more people feeling the passion for life? Could you have written this article? If not today, often, right? Why is it that a nation that has such incredible natural resources, such incredible art, such incredible sports, such incredible opportunity for everybody, incredible education opportunities with the best colleges in the world, great houses and cars and highways. Have you gone out and visited the natural splendor that is the United States of America? I mean, it is absolutely gorgeous. And so why is it that in this nation that promotes life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, why is it that the CDC, the Center for Disease Control, tells me that one out of every 10 Americans is on antidepressant drugs? Why is it that Harvard Magazine did a study on antidepressant drugs and they found out that antidepressant drug usage does not change due to economic status? So when someone says money's not everything but it can buy you happiness, tell them they're wrong. Proven. Right there. It doesn't matter how much, more money will not take you off the drug and fulfill your life and make you happy. It doesn't work. More money, more stuff. I want more time and I got all these devices to kind of give me more time and then I end up spending all my time on them. They don't work. More stuff, more knowledge. Knowledge crazy, information crazy, society, more college degrees, more sex, more hobbies, more channels, better health. These are not the way to true happiness, but yet we pursue them earnestly. Why? Why do we do that? They're not the way to be happy. But listen, there is a way. There is a way. And I have described this way to you these last few weeks. Last week we really told you about the way, didn't we? But I've tried to describe this way to you, and if you haven't been here before, try to envision this. It's a dance. And you're with Jesus. Can you feel his hand on your lower back? Can you feel his hand in your hand? That's the problem. It's the dance. That's the way to live. It's not just all you, it's not just all him, it's working in unison with the lover of your soul. As he leads, you follow. It's the way to live. It's the way to happiness. It's not just what you do, it's the why you do it. It's the whole new way of thinking, whole new way of life, whole new way of thinking, talking, everything that we do, but it's more than that, it's why. It's why we live the way we do. Not just a bunch of rules that you have to keep so that he'll love you. It's not the way it is. There's a reason why we do the things that we do. That's not just the creative mind of some guy. This is actually derived from the text, right in Scripture. I'd like to share that with you, if I may. If we look in our text here in Psalm 119, look at verses 4 through 7. You have charged us to keep your commandments carefully. That's God leading. Do you see it there? Oh, that my actions would consistently reflect your decrees. That's me submitting, saying, oh, I want that. Then I will not be ashamed when I compare my life to your commands. As I learn your righteous regulations, I will thank you by living as I should. I will obey your decrees. God leads, I submit, I want it, I learn it, I live it, I do it, I walk it, I dance. That's what we do. That's what we do. God, let's start here. God leads. Stand up, pick up your mat, and go home. Have no gods before me. Follow me. Lower your nets. Pray for your enemies. Give to the poor. Let no unclean word come from your mouth. Forgive. Never repay back evil with evil. Repent. Love the Lord and love your neighbor. I could go on for a month about these things. All laws, all commands, his decrees, his judgments. That's what he said. None of them are suggestions. That's God leading you. Do you feel it? Now you might feel it. Maybe you're looking for that elegant sway of dancing with the stars. We don't get that from our leader. We get commands. This is the way you should do things. Do you feel God leading you? Psalm 32:8 says, "The Lord says, I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. I will advise you and watch over you." Isn't that awesome? He's given us these commands. He's told us how to walk. He's advising you. Hey, listen, man, this is the way you should live. And then he's watching over you. He's there to protect you. He's there to guide you. But he's also watching to see if you're going to do it. Now you feel his hand, probably. Instead of here, it's right here, right? It's a little different hand position. But that's our Lord. He puts us on the right path through his commands. The famous American poet, Robert Frost. I'm not a big Robert Frost guy, just going to kind of quote him here, but some of you may be. But he's probably, I would venture to say, probably the most famous of American poets. He once wrote this: "Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled, and that has made all the difference." Those are good words, right? But I think he plagiarized. I think there's some plagiarism there. Maybe he's not as good as everyone says he is, because I think he stole something from Jesus. Tell me if I'm right. Jesus said in Matthew 7, verses 13 and 14, "The highway to hell is broad and its gate is wide for the many who choose that way. But the gateway to life is very narrow and the road is difficult and only a few ever find it." I can't possibly love you unless I ask you if you found that road. I can't possibly love you well if I haven't asked you if you found that road. Because there's a lot of people in this world that are saying that they're Christians, but according to this text, out of the mouth of Jesus, all those that say that they are might not be. So I plead with you, have you found the narrow road and it's difficult? See, we need to throw away this false illusion that when I bend my knee to Jesus, everything's going to be better. All of his disciples and his apostles were killed. Jesus himself went to the cross and he was tortured. So what makes us think that our life is going to be, you know, unicorns and bunnies? It's not always going to work out that way. God's word is a lamp for my feet. It is the light for my path. It is the way that I should go, but only if you want to be joyful. It's up to you. Only if you want to be blessed. Only if you want to be happy. And you all raised your hands. Some of you raised two. So I'm loving you well here by telling you that there is a way for you to be happy. And God has laid it out before you clearly in his word. And so you have to choose what you will do with your days. You need to choose how you will pursue happiness. Will you pursue it in the ways you've been doing it, only to find a dead end every single time and wonder why and never ever get out of being grumpy? Or will you stubbornly lay down your pride and your way and try something different? I beg you. I beg you. You have to choose. But now let me ask you a question. Does anyone know what God's word has to say about this choice? See, we read it a moment ago, and I want to bring you back to it. Look at verse 5. Because verse 4 said he's charged us to keep the commands consistently, right? That's just not on church day, not on Saturday or Sunday, consistently. That's all the time, every day. I want to read this one. Hold on a second. Look back at verse 3. He said, these people, they don't compromise with evil, but they stay only on his path. They don't compromise with evil. Now, don't leave me hanging up here, but aren't we all prone to do that? We'll compromise. We'll go to the negotiation table with Satan and go, you know what? I'm not doing exactly what I'm supposed to do, but what if I just do a little bit? I'm better than her. Look at her. Look what she does. I'm better than her. I'm better than I used to be. I'm not like getting wasted 7 days a week now. I'm only doing it 5. Listen, don't use the excuse, well, I'm better than I used to be. This says here that the God's people, they don't compromise with evil. Right? They don't compromise with, they don't say, well, I'm a Christian, but there's no buts. This is a Christian but. Listen, the but doesn't keep him from loving you, but the but will keep you from being happy. It will keep you from being happy. Because he doesn't bless unfaithfulness. He tells us what to do, and he's charged us to follow his commands consistently. Not throw it out the window when you leave. Can I pick on you for a second? I love you. On her van, let me finish, please. Don't say anything yet, because I'm going to love you well. On her van, she has a sticker, "I love Jesus, but I cuss a little." Now listen. She's not making an excuse. I had to get right with the sticker, because it pissed me off for a long time. I had to get right with the sticker because I needed to look at, I know Mary's heart. Her heart is not to say that it's okay to keep cussing. Her heart is to let people know who cuss that Jesus loves them. Someone say amen, amen. Right? But I also know that she knows it's not best that she keeps potty mouthing forever, that when you come to Christ, you become more like him. I don't know about you, but I don't know that Jesus was dropping cuss words. It just doesn't happen, right? So we're supposed to be progressing in godliness, right? Becoming more and more like him, glory to glory, more and more like Jesus, conformed into the image of his son. So we have to choose to not compromise. Don't even go to the table, man, right? Don't go to the table. Don't offer a seat to the enemy and let him, because he's forked-tongued, he's crafty, and he'll make you slip up. You ain't that good. I'm not that good either. He's a master closer. And so you don't want to even get to the table with him. Don't compromise with evil. The answer to what I should do with this charge to keep the commandments is right there in verse 5. Oh, that my actions would consistently reflect your decrees. God's word tells us that we should want his decrees. We should want to live up to what God's word says. We should. So that's the second thing. First thing is that God leads through his commandments, right? The second thing is I want that. And that's what I beg for all of you. Tonight you should be able to say without a question of a doubt, you should holler at the top of your voice, I want that. I want that. I want God's word. I crave God's word. I long for God's word. It is a treasure of magnitude. You can't even imagine what you have in your hand. I should want God's word. Oh, that my actions, can you, when you read that, without me yelling to enhance it, can you read that verse and sense his longing? Can you? I don't need to help you with that, right? Oh, you can hear it in his voice. Oh, that my actions would consistently reflect your decrees. That's not the only verse in this single psalm that talks about this. Look at verse 20. I am always overwhelmed with the desire for your regulations. I'm overwhelmed with desire for the Bible. I can't wait to get up and read and mine from this treasure what you would have for me today. I want this, Lord. I'm overwhelmed by this, Lord. Not, hey, let's turn to this verse. And you're like, oh, can we get out of here already? No, it's like, yeah, give me more, preacher. I want more. I long for it. That's what I'd love to see. The NIV would say it a little bit differently. Verse 20 says, my soul is consumed with longing for your laws at all time. I'm overwhelmed with desire. My soul is consumed with longing for you. Where's that in the church? Where's that in the church of Jesus Christ? I never quote the Message Bible, never, but I have to here, man. Eugene Peterson wrote this Bible called The Message. It's just an enhancement. It's a paraphrase to help us understand what God's Word's trying to say. So I want to bring this up on the screen. I want you to see what it says from The Message in Psalm 119, verse 20, from The Message translation. My soul is starved and hungry, ravenous and insatiable for your nourishing commands. I love that. That's awesome. It's ravenous like an animal, man. I insatiable desire, right? And if you have an insatiable desire for the Lord, the awesome thing is that because he's eternal, that his awesomeness never runs out. So you can have an insatiable appetite for the Lord forever and always get more and more of Jesus. So are you overwhelmed with desire for his word? Does your soul, is it consumed with longing for the word of God? Is it starved and hungry? Am I ravenous, insatiably pursuing and wanting God's word spoken into my life? I don't know. Look at verse 40. I long to obey your commandments. Verse 58. With all my heart, I want your blessings. Verse 82, this is just one psalm. My eyes are straining to see your promises come true. Verse 131, I love this. I pant with expectation, longing for your commands. Do you have a longing in your life? Are you starving for the word of Almighty God to speak it into your life? It's the word that gives hope. It's the word that gives peace. It's the word that delivers us. It's the word that heals us. It's the word that spoke and creation came. It's the word of God speaking into your life. Do you long for this thing? Are you ravenously pursuing every day God's word into your life? Psalm 63:1, my soul thirsts for you. My whole body longs for you. Psalm 42:1, as the deer longs for streams of water, so my soul longs for you, O God. Do you long for him? Are you straining and striving and ravenously pursuing God's word, his nourishing word, his commands, his laws that give you life, that bring life into your body? Are you pursuing this thing every single day? Do you long for him? Do you always have an overwhelming desire to read and to be led and dance? See, joyful, blessed, and happy people are the ones who, according to this text here, according to verse 2, are the ones who search for him with all their heart. There's not a whole lot of blessing and happiness outside of your whole heart. Jeremiah 29:12 tells us to search for me with your whole heart and you will find me. You search half-hearted, lethargic, complacent, put a Z sticker on your car, gets you nowhere. If you want to find the Lord, he has given you a way. And there's only one way. And it's this way that I proclaim to you today. That's it. If you want to be happy, this is it. I want this. I need this. I value this. I want God's word. I want to be happy. I want to search with all my heart. Some of you might be there right now. If you feel that brewing up inside of you right now, like, hey, that's the person that I'm not, but I'd really like to be that guy. I'd really like to be that gal. Many of you may be feeling that right now as God's word pierces your heart and changes the way you think. But you got to ask yourself, well, what's that look like? Because you can't really get to a place if you don't have a target, right? How are we going to get there if we don't know what we're looking for? So let me just share with you what God's word says right here in this psalm about what that looks like to search for him with your whole heart. Amen? Look at verse 15. Don't you love when God's word is just simple? You don't need anyone translating. You don't need a concordance. You don't need a commentary. It just kind of says it, right? What's it say? I will study your commandments. Boom. That's it. I'll study your commandments. I will study your commandments. I will come to church. I will sit down with my Bible, and I will have my notebook open, and I will have my pen in my hand. Why would you come? Let me just ask you, why would you come to church without a notebook? Why would you read the Bible without a notebook? Why wouldn't you take notes and let him speak to you and get some references and some thoughts and what someone's saying and jot some things down? You know what studying God's word is? That means learning what it means. It's not just a reading plan that you open up the back of your Bible and go, I can read through this in a year. Whoop-dee, stinking doo-dah. You have to study the Word of God. You can read it. Look, a stone-cold atheist could read the Word of God. It wouldn't make any difference. You got to study. It says you got to study the Word of God. Right? That's what it says, right? Am I making it up? Did I make that up? Or did you read it? It says, I will study your commandments. So that's what we do. We want to learn, what does this say? What does this mean, right? If you don't know what it means, it doesn't do you any good. I'm a Bible believer. Really? What do you believe? I will study your commandments. That means I will learn what it means. Look at verse 52. Here's the second thing. Not making any of this up, right? You want to go to church where it's made up? Don't come here. I meditate on your age-old regulations. I will study your word, and then what will I do? I will meditate on your word. If studying the word of God means pulling out your notebook and concordances and all this kind of definition stuff, and you start studying and taking notes and learning what it means, that's what studying is. Meditating means I want to know what it means for me. I want to say, God, in my situation, in my circumstance, with my family and my finances and my job and my nation and my neighborhood and my health and my overall spiritual health and all this stuff, I want to know what this means to me. I want to know what this means, this Psalm 119. It sounds good, joyful. What does that mean to me? So studying it means learning what it means. Meditating means learning what it means to me. And then look at verse 11. Two verses here. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Verse 93 says, I will never forget your commandments. Listen to this, guys. For by them you give me life. It's a treasure. What does this mean? I will memorize. I will not forget them. I will commit them to memory. I will study to understand what they mean. I will meditate to say what they mean to me. And I will memorize them so that I cannot be killed. I cannot be led into death. I cannot be attacked by the enemy, and he won't win. Jesus Christ in the desert, when he was faced with the devil himself, what did he do? He quoted the word of God. And so if Jesus needed the word of God to make the devil leave, why would you think you could do it without it? Who are you? Who am I? I'm nothing. We study it. We meditate on it. Psalm 1 says, in the second verse, he says, the ones who are joyful, the ones who delight in the law of the Lord, meditating on it day and night, they are like a tree planted by the river, sucking up nourishment in every season. They're flourishing, they're growing, they're healthy, they're happy all the time, no matter what happens. That could be you. That could be you if you would spend time in God's word. God charged me to follow his word. I want this. I need this. I value this. I want to be happy. I've studied. I've meditated. I've memorized. Well, then what? Well, look back at the text. Just following God's word. This is the path. He said, I'll put you on the path. I'll advise you. I'll watch over you. Look at verse 7. As I learn your righteous regulations. So since I've studied them and I've meditated on them and I've memorized them, is that it? As I learn your righteous regulations, I will thank you by living as I should. I will obey your decrees. We don't study, we don't meditate, we don't memorize and go, I got it, Lord. He didn't say, go forth and memorize my word. He said, go do as I do. You don't know what he did unless you know the word, but you don't just end there. You go do what he said to do. That's where happiness is found. Here's the third thing, I just mentioned it, it's that I do it. I dance. God leads, I say I want it, and then I do it. James, Jesus' half-brother, if you will, they had the same mom. Different dad, right? Broken families can be good, man. I'm just saying. Gives me hope. Holy God. What are you laughing about over there, man? James said, don't just be hearers of the word, but be doers of the word. So as we long for his word, as we learn his word, the next step is what? We do it. We do what he says. We walk in his ways. We dance with him. And if this is you, that's awesome. But if it's not you, why not? Why isn't this you? Why no longing for God's word? Why no insatiable, ravenous appetite to study, meditate, and memorize God's word? Why no due conviction? Why? Why do we too often settle for the easy way instead of pursuing the best way and assuming that something's going to get better? Why? 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 Do you know why? I do. And it's not because I'm awesome or intelligent beyond anyone in this room at all, by no means. It's because I know what God's word says about it. Do you want to know what it says? Okay. Keep your finger in Psalm 119 and go to Hebrews chapter 4. This is the point of the night where you should be going, man, I love that. You're giving me more Bible. Gorge me, man. I want it. I want God's word. I got Greg back there. He does. That's why I come. Huh? Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. You ready? Y'all there? Are you eagerly pursuing his regulations right now? Does he have your undivided attention? For the word of God is alive and powerful. It is sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes, this is the part you need to hear, it exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God. Everything is naked, go, and exposed before his eyes, and he is the one to whom we are accountable. Go back. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. Nothing in all creation is hidden from the Lord. That's what his word does. Okay? So if we go back to Psalm 119, right into our text, verse 5, oh, that my actions would consistently reflect your decrees. Watch. Then, see, if my actions would consistently reflect your decrees, it'd be one thing. Then I would not be ashamed when I compare my life with your commands. See, the reason why there's no longing and craving God's word is because of shame. Because when we know, if we've read the Bible at all, we open up the scriptures and we see a high watermark that is so high when it says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Yeah. And when we open up the Bible, we say, like, this is not the way I'm living my life. Look, if you will, the next page, verse 59, it says, when I pondered the direction of my life, I turned to follow your laws. See, no one really wants to, let's be honest, we don't want to ponder the direction of our life often. Because when we look at this, and we look at our life, we're like, yeah, the way I'm living is really not this way. We compromise with evil. That's what we do. We don't want to read this because we're afraid of what it's going to tell us. We're afraid of him telling us, we don't need to do this anymore, we need to do this. We don't want to hear that. We have shame in our life, but he's here to take away your shame. Right? There's no shame in the game with Jesus. He knows everything that you've done, everything you've thought, everything you've said, every place you've ever been, and he still willingly went to the cross to pay for your sin. He loves you. It doesn't make any difference. There is no shame in his game. It needs to be out the window. But that's the problem. We have shame. And you know why? Because like it says, it knows our innermost thoughts and our desires. God's word outs every single one of us. Everyone. I don't care who you are. You could be Mother Teresa, the Pope, Billy Graham. It doesn't make any difference who you are. God's word outs that person. Because no one can live up to this standard. So there should be no shame in the game. No one can live up to this standard. But when I read and I compare the word to my life, I feel shamed. So if the path of least resistance, the path that is narrow that few people take, is the path of insatiable desire for God's word. I want the word. I will study the word. I will meditate on the word. I will memorize the word. I will do the word. That's the road that Jesus said is narrow and few people find it, right? So what's the road that's most often traveled? It's called avoidance road. It's called make excuses road. It's called pursuing things that will never give real happiness except the word of God road. That's what we do. If you don't think it's true, let me just tell you this. Christianity Today in 2012, they wrote an article. They surveyed just over 2,900, listen, church-going Christians. 3 times a month at least. Okay, these are people that say they're Christians and actually go to church at least 3 times a week. They did a survey, and 90% of these people checked off the box that said that they desire to please and honor Jesus in all that they do. Is that a big number? That's a good number, right? I think it's awful. See, we settle for too little. Let me just take you down this little road for a second. Do you know that it's your sin that puts Jesus on the cross? Do you understand it's my sin and yours that made Jesus get whipped and beaten and stripped down naked in public and slapped and insulted and stretched and spiked and stabbed and killed? That's the reason why that happened, is because of our sin. But yet he loves us enough that he went through that willingly, rose from the grave to give us sinners, the ones who put him on that cross, life. Now, when you think about that one thing, should 10% of Christians that go to church ever not mark the box that says that they don't want to live a life that pleases Jesus in every single thing that they do? Come on now. 10% of church-going believers don't want to please Jesus in all that they do? Come on! That's crazy! But in this world of compromise and shallowness, we'll just all agree that 90 is a good number. So we'll go back. 90 is a pretty good number. That was my soapbox. But here's the disturbing thing. Only 19% of the people that want to please Jesus in everything they do, only 19% of them will daily pick up their Bible and read it. 19%. And you wonder why you're not happy. You wonder why you live a life of no purpose or fulfillment, when God has clearly laid out the path before you, and 19% actually read. I'm convicted. And I'm a pastor. Because I don't do that. Why do only 19% read and study and meditate and memorize daily? Yeah, we'll eat daily. We'll work daily. We'll work out daily. We'll Facebook daily. We'll Instagram daily. We'll Snapchat daily. We'll play sports. We'll watch sports. We'll watch TV. We'll do all these different things. And these things aren't bad. But none of them will provide the happiness that you're putting on top of them to provide for you. And why will you do that but yet know God's word that gives hope and life and peace? Why? God's word calls me out, and so I avoid it. And most people are. That's the first reason. Here's the second and final reason why there's no longing, no panting, no daily overwhelming desire for God's word. It's due to a lack of the fear of the Lord. There's no fear of the Lord anymore. No fear of the Lord. And I fear that there's not enough fear of the Lord in the church of Jesus Christ today. We don't understand who it is that we're talking about. We don't understand who it is that we're standing in the presence of right now. His train filled the temple. His throne is high and lifted up. That's who God is. We don't have enough fear of the Lord. Look at verse 38 of Psalm 119. My eyes are going. Reassure me of your promise made to those who fear you. Verse 63, I am a friend to anyone who fears you, anyone who obeys your commandments. Verse 79, let me be united with all who fear you. And then it further explains, with those who know your laws. Verse 120, I tremble in fear of you. I stand in awe of your regulations. There's not enough fear of the Lord in the church today. How many people love God's grace? How many people love God's love? But how many people fear the Lord? Proverbs 1:7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Proverbs 8:13, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. Pride and arrogancy and the evil way and the froward mouth do I hate. Matthew 10:28, and fear not them which could kill the body, people, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Ecclesiastes, Solomon said in 12:13, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. This is what everything is. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. Proverbs 14:26, in the fear of the Lord is strong confidence, and his children shall have a place of refuge. Job 28:28, and unto man he said, behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom, and to depart from evil is understanding. Psalm 33:8, let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. Deuteronomy 10:12, and now Israel, that's God's people, that's you. What does the Lord thy God require of thee? It's another command. But to fear the Lord thy God, to walk in all his ways, and to love him, and to serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul. Proverbs 14:27, the fear of the Lord is a fountain of life, to depart from the snares of death. Proverbs 3:7, be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. Psalm 25:14, the secret of the Lord is with them that fear him, and he shall show them his covenant. Here's New Testament, Luke 1:50, and his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. Psalm 111, verse 10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and good understanding have all that they do. His commandments, his praise endureth forever. Psalm 86:11, teach me thy way, O Lord. I will walk in the truth. Unite my heart to fear thy name. Philippians 2:12-13, wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Proverbs 16:6, by mercy and truth, iniquity is purged, and by the fear of the Lord, men depart from evil. Psalm 34:9, O fear the Lord, ye his saints, for there is no want to them that fear him. We need to fear the Lord. We need to fear the Lord. I'm going to call the worship team back up to close out our night. But I want to just say the fear of the Lord is needed in the church. And the fear of the Lord is this. Fear of the Lord is an accurate view of your smallness and an accurate view of his humongousness, if you will. That's the fear of the Lord. Not fear that he wants to kill me or hurt me because he hates me, but fear the power that is his and his alone. That's the fear of the Lord. This God that we speak of here in this comfortable setting every week is the one who spoke, and there comes creation out of his mouth at 186,000 miles per second. That's the fear of the Lord. And this creation that is as far as we could possibly see, the fringes of his robe, the Bible would say. When he came down to Israel at Mount Sinai to meet with his people, it said that the mountain was shaking in his presence. And we should stand in awe of this God and his regulations. He is the God that looked at the storm and the waves and he said, stop, and they did. That's the God that I'm sharing with you tonight.
Amen.
This accurate view will drive you to his word because you realize the value that is found in God's word. It is this God that gave us this word that gives us hope and peace and life and happiness to those who study it, who meditate on it daily. They will be the happy ones. I need it, Lord. The fear of God puts me in awe of who he is. So I would value that input into my life. Can we just pray together? Can we pray to him right now, please? I'm boldly saying that every head should be bowed in the presence of this awe-inspiring, creation-speaking, storm-stopping God. Can we just start by repenting? Lord, let me be the first, Lord. I repent. I repent of seeking happiness in other things other than the only thing that will bring me happiness, true happiness for my soul. I have not ravenously, insatiably, overwhelming, desiringly, soul longingly pursued the word of God. Not nearly like I should. There are things in my life, and I know of all of us in here, that take up more of our time and more of our attention than the very word that gives life. How foolish we are. It's no wonder when you came to your people, you wept because we were lost, like sheep without a shepherd. So, Lord, we repent. Lord, we offer our lives to you right now. We would beg you, Father. We would beg you. We would keep knocking. We would keep asking, Lord, that you would birth in us a reality that true happiness can only come by insatiably longing, studying and meditating and memorizing and doing your word. It's the only way. Lord, that you even gave us a way is awesome. It is us that put you on the cross, yet your love is so incredible that you gave us a way to find happiness and joy and purpose and fulfillment that's found in your word. Oh, your precious, precious word. Lord, we offer ourselves to you now. We want to dance with you. We want to feel your arms around us. We want to feel your hand on our lower back. We want to feel your other hand in our hand. Lead us. Help us not to travel down the avoidance road anymore, but to pursue you with our whole heart. This I pray in Jesus' name.